fresh facts about Coca-Cola. Hey everyone, it's Lexa, and welcome back to another video. You can't escape Coca-Cola, no matter how much you try. Most of you probably sip on that carbonated goodness on a regular basis, but what do you know about this worldwide company and their famous beverage? Keep watching for some fresh facts. Coca-Cola invented Santa Claus. One of the keys to Coca-Cola's sales strategies was to make use of publicity campaigns, such as using iconic images or attractive female spokesmodels. These campaigns were highly effective. The first ads, designed by none other than Norman Rockwell himself. In the 1930s, Coca-Cola introduced a new ad depicting Santa Claus in a bright red suit, and it just happened to match the company colors. It was actually these ads that helped shape the image of Santa Claus in the United States. Trying to get rid of coffee. Can you imagine Starbucks selling soft drinks instead of coffee? Yeah, most of us can't imagine that either, but Coke certainly tried. In an attempt to rival coffee, Coca-Cola attempted to advertise their product as a morning drink with a little campaign called Coke in the Morning. In 1988, Coca-Cola launched this campaign in a few cities, suggesting it's easier and faster to chug a cup full of Coca-Cola in the morning than chug a hot cup of coffee. Fast forward 30 years later, and clearly, this idea did not work. The founder was a colonel. Did you know that Coca-Cola is a Georgia native? Founder John Stith Pemberton was born in 1831 in Knoxville, Georgia. After graduating the Reform Medical College of Georgia, he became a licensed pharmacist. When the Civil War broke out, Pemberton enlisted with the Confederate Army and rose his way up to the rank of colonel. He was critically wounded during the war, and while recovering, he became addicted to morphine. A chemist by trade, he decided to try and find a way to break his dependence on the highly addictive drug by creating an adequate substitute. Thus, the seeds for what would become Coca-Cola were planted. Booze and cocaine. In 1885, Pemberton created his first formulation, called Dr. Tuggle's Compound Syrup of Globe Flower, which was met with limited success. He then experimented with coca, ending up with a combination of cola nut, coca, and damiana, a type of shrub that was known for its aphrodisiac qualities and anti-anxiety qualities. He called it Pemberton's French Wine Coca. Pemberton advertised the product as specifically beneficial for ladies and all those whose sedentary employment causes nervous prostration. When Georgia enacted temperance legislation, Pemberton went back to the drawing board to figure out how to remove the alcohol. The legacy of New Coke. Eventually, Pemberton removed the alcohol, making it closer to the soft drink we all know and love today. If you weren't around during the 1980s, then you probably have only heard of New Coke. New Coke became this elusive thing of legend, the Coca-Cola Company's venture into changing their recipe. A wave of criticism hit the company after consumers got mad that they would even do such a thing because the company didn't just introduce the new flavor, they replaced the classic recipe completely. However, did you know that despite this, New Coke stuck around for nearly two more decades? Old Classic Coke came back, but they didn't stop manufacturing it until 2002. What they did try to do is rebrand it by calling it Coke 2. The original Coke bottle. After Pemberton's passing in 1888, a man named Asa Griggs Candler took over the business. Once the 1900s rolled around, Candler decided to distribute the drink into glass bottles instead of the traditional fountain drink found at drugstores. Not long after, all their competitors sold their soft drinks in glass bottles too. Although Coca-Cola contains no cocoa, a bottling plant in Indiana thought that it did and designed a glass container in the shape of a cocoa bean. Over the years, the bottle slimmed down a bit, but glass Coke bottles still hold that curvy bean shape. A collection of beverages. Not only does Coca-Cola sell that iconic dark soda that comes in the red packaging, but they are also behind the production and sale of other soft drinks. These include Sprite and Fanta. At the same time, they own other non-soda beverage brands such as Minute Maid, Dasani, Vitamin Water, Powerade, Gold Peak, Simply, and many more. Coca-Cola's product portfolio consists of 500 brands and over 3,500 different beverages. Currently, they stand as the top provider of still and sparkling drinks. Crack is whack. The coca in Coca-Cola once stood for cocaine, and it was one of the primary ingredients of the drink. Each glass contained roughly 9 milligrams of it, later removed by 1903. Pemberton decided to tweak the formula again. Instead of using fresh coca leaves, he chose to use spent coca leaves, left over from the cocaine extraction process. These leaves also happened to contain trace amounts of cocaine. So while he reduced the quantity of cocaine in the recipe, elements of it still found their way into each glass. The company's value. With all those products and brands, you know they're making bank. If you purchased stock in 1919, it would have cost you about $40. By 2012, it would have been worth $9.8 million. According to a report from the New York Times, the value of the Coca-Cola brand totaled out to $79.2 billion, making it one of the top brands in the world. In addition to presiding over all those drinks, Coca-Cola used to own the film studio company Columbia Pictures. They bought Columbia Pictures in 1982 and sold the studio to Sony after the commercial failure of the film Ishtar in 1987. Invented by trial and error. Pemberton enlisted the aid of his friend and drugstore owner, Willis E. Venable, to help him test and perfect his new beverage, mostly through trial and error. It was during one of these tests that Pemberton accidentally blended the base syrup with carbonated water. Pleased with the result, he decided to sell the new concoction as a fountain drink, since it no longer resembled wine once he removed the alcohol. It was Frank Mason Robinson who coined the term Coca-Cola based on its two main ingredients. A Coca-Cola world. Everywhere you travel, you can rest easy knowing you can buy a Coke there, except for a handful of places. For instance, if you ever find yourself touring North Korea, you cannot purchase a Coke because they officially don't sell it. The same goes for Cuba. The Arab League boycotted the company in 1968, though Coca-Cola resumed operations in Iraq by 2005. On Coca-Cola's website, they claim they sell their product in over 200 countries, even though only 196 independent nations in the world exist. So really, this probably means other places don't sell Coke as well, but as for knowing where, it's difficult to say. Coke for babies. When Coca-Cola first became a beverage product in the 1800s, parents used to put drops of the drink in their babies' bottles, or even just feed them the drops. Back then, many believed that administering small amounts of Coca-Cola to fussy, crying babies would help calm them down. Nowadays, Coca-Cola is not at all recommended to give infants and smaller children. When you're that young, your digestive system is super delicate, and introducing something as acidic and full of sugar like Coca-Cola isn't a good idea. Drinking Coke frequently at that young of an age can lead to dehydration or act as a diuretic because of the caffeine. The cure-all. To sell the new beverage he just made, Pemberton marketed it as a temperance drink, i.e. non-alcoholic, that was delicious, refreshing, exhilarating, and invigorating. He also made a bunch of wild statements about the product, including many health claims, saying it was a valuable brain tonic and a most wonderful invigorator of the organs that would cure headaches, calm nerves, provide energy, and relieve drug addiction. A clear Coke for a general. Shortly after World War II, Dwight D. Eisenhower introduced Coca-Cola to Georgi Zhukov, the marshal of the Soviet Union during the 1940s. It sounds innocent, but the drink's introduction to a Russian figure proved a problem because Coca-Cola stands as a symbol of American imperialism. To avoid any controversy with Stalinist Russia, Zhukov requested his Coke to be served as a clear, colorless drink so that it more closely resembled vodka. Russia would not receive the classic Coke until 1985. Buy a Coke for a nickel. Coca-Cola used to cost 5 cents per bottle. Wouldn't it be nice to bring back the old days? In its first year, Pemberton only sold 9 glasses per day. He even invented the first coupon ever. In 1888, he distributed tickets that customers could redeem for a free glass of Coca-Cola. By 1913, the company reported customers turning in 8.5 million tickets. Of course, sales have steadily increased since those early days, and today, Coca-Cola averages approximately 1.9 billion servings a day worldwide. Serving size? Today, the world consumes Coke at a rate of 1.9 billion every day. That's a stark contrast to the 9 drinks per day back in the first year of its creation in 1886. In 2018, the Coca-Cola Company ranked at number 87 on the Fortune 500 list as the largest corporation by total revenue in the United States. It might surprise you to hear that Coca-Cola manufactures and sells concentrate. That concentrate then heads on over to Coca-Cola bottlers, who mix the concentrate with filtered water and sweeteners. Standing out from the crowd. In the early 1900s, Coca-Cola thought their plain, straight-sided bottle lacked distinction. Since their bottle looked like everyone else's, it didn't help distinguish Coca-Cola from the other copycat brands. So they approached the Root Glass Company and asked them to come up with a redesign, something that would help it stand out from the rest of the competition. Root Glass delivered the contour-shaped bottle we all know and love today. It was an immediate hit when they introduced it in 1916, and the distinctive design is still a hit with customers today, winning numerous design awards over the years. Hey, nice six-pack. In 1923, Coca-Cola introduced the concept of a six-pack for the first time. This novel idea allowed a person to take home 6 bottles of Coca-Cola at a time. Advertisements began showing the cardboard boxes that would make carrying the bottles a piece of cake. This new format also tied in with another new invention at the time, home refrigeration. You could bring your extra bottles of Coca-Cola home and keep them chilled until you were ready to drink them. The six-pack carton was a revolutionary idea that soon became commonplace throughout the industry. What's next? Before we reveal number one, we're going to ask you this. Are you more of a Coke or Pepsi kind of person? Let us know why in the comments below. Bringing the world together, one Coke at a time. Before 1899, Coca-Cola only sold drinks via soda fountains, a highly segregated commodity. By the time 1899 rolled around, the company decided to sell Coca-Cola in bottles as well. This new form allowed them to increase sales by reaching out to a larger community, including the minority community, which had not previously had the opportunity to sample the beverage. This demographic shift played a small part in improving race relations at the time.